Brian?
Yep.
You're dealing with this as well?
I am dealing with this as well. Okay, Chair, so, what's it called? This came to the panel before Christmas. The panel has expressed a strong desire to see information presented in graphical form and a bit wider scope of information as well. So that's what I'm doing in the appendix. Just to take you through the various appendices that are there. Which basically looks at the ticket sales in terms of car parking, tickets sales, and some information on the income. You've got some information on the mark score for the period of time that we some indication on what happened sort of over the Christmas period, which is Christmas sort of retail, etc. So the first graph is appendix one, that shows the weekly borough ticket sales, and that's specifically for the 13 weeks that was originally requested as part of the works work program. So I did put little markers on the lines, so we can don't repeat using colour. So hopefully they're fairly clear as to what line represents each one. And basically, I guess the most the reason why is the 2006 one is the one with the circle line, so the lightest line that shows the one with the circle.
2016, not 2006.
2016. Sorry. Thank you. Yeah. Then appendix two, which is the second half, that's on a monthly basis then, over a financial year perspective, going from 2011-12 up to the current position for 16-17, i.e. up until the end of December, that's the last 4 months we've got. And again, the 16-17 position is the line with the circle. So that one's for the needs of appendix two. We then got one for Bedworth, exactly the same as the financial year, the same financial year, and again the 16-17 one is the one with the circle on. And then we've got the bullet point, which amalgamates those two in appendix four. So that's the same. Appendix five, which actually hasn't reproduced as well as I thought it might do, because those two colours are extremely different if you see the colour through the hatched and dotted next one. That's the total numbers of 1 hour parking tickets sold between 2015 and 16, taken from May to December. The reason why it's gone from May is that the changeover in pricing and tariff boards, etc., that happened in April. So April is skewed. The fundamental reason I put that there, Chair, is that in every month we sold less 1 hour tickets in 2016 than we did in 2015, and the price hasn't changed. Then appendix six is income. So before we look at ticket sales, appendix six is income, and again, don't have four financial years, 13-14, so it's the current position, 16-17. That's slightly different. I don't know why I think that's slightly different, but it'll be on a different day. But the 2016-17 is a rhombus, I think that's the right phrase for it, or the diamond shape for it. At the bottom there, again, it's the lightest line that you can see there. So that's sort of the car parking aspects. Appendix 7 shows the number of market stalls in Bedworth, and we've got there the darkest line there, and the circles is what's been happening in 2016. try and just make some points that from a couple of pieces of research, and this is something that needs paradoxical. We make a point that undoubtedly car parking charges have some influence as to where people decide to go and how they'll go forward and what happens. But they're not the only, it's not the only influencing factors there. There are more things that are like people's decision to go to town or central cities than just the cost of parking. And then the last one really was from last Friday, actually. This is an article on the BBC website, which just flagged that the resale fell sharp in December. Interestingly, November, and particularly Black Friday, which turned into sort of Black Week, really, but people were ringing up upwards of events. November, retail sales up, and then dropped fairly dramatically in December, across the country as a whole, and across various sectors. But I felt that the one of the really interesting points is the fourth sentence from the end of that, where the shoppers also bought more online, spending about £1 billion a week, which is 21.3% higher than December 2015, which I think just really does emphasise the change in people's shopping habits from physically going somewhere to shop, rather than and now it's about doing it online, either having it delivered to home or picking it up with a collect plus or something like that. It's convenient for you to go and pick it up. You see, that reflects my opinion in ways, is the new Asian shop is just around the corner. So that's the information I tell you. It's hopefully more understandable and helpful to be handled on what the position has been on those things over the last few years and 2016-17 today.
Any comments?
I might as well start. I love graphs. It's really hard to look at tables, and those tables we had a month ago are really hard. These graphs actually make quite a good picture, particularly if you look at them online in colour. And what happens to the... I actually quite like the further back graphs, where you've done the current year and not darker.
Yeah, that
works.
Yeah, it was smart.
Your technique was getting better as you went to the later graphs.
That's my perfect answer.
It's on a learning curve. I'm sure I'll get there in the end.
But one of the really serious things has been what the impact has been on the Needham for the over one-hour stays. Because as you said, and everyone said, the one-hour stay has stayed at £1. And for a lot of people nipping into Bedworth, that don't want to upset
people.
You've got
free parking in Bedworth.
The length of stays in the Needham will inherently be longer than the length of stays in Bedworth. And we can see from the Needham graph, when it came in, April was pretty similar to any other month. May, we lost about 10,000 visitors a month visiting the Needham car parks. And then in June time, we started with the loss of the big shops, the Co-op and the British Home Stores and things. So it's a complicated picture. It's not saying that car parking issues are all down to the charges. You know, there are several factors. But there has clearly been an elasticity of demand. I don't know which way around elasticity. There's been an impact of actually you charge more and people will go somewhere else in small numbers. And we might be able to quantify the effect of 5% or 10%. But it's clear that over the total impact of the town, we're 20% down potentially in the Needham by December time. It's really interesting to see far less change in Bedworth because you have got a lot of free parking, people will be doing shorter stays, etc. And actually the income ones are really interesting because we put the charges up by roughly 20% of stays over an hour. And we've received just about the same level of income as we have in previous years. And that is the sort of thing you expect when there's a certain amount of money you can raise in car parking. It's about £2 million with council. And the more you try to raise by increasing fees, you get more money but from fewer people. And then that has a real detrimental impact on the small traders. And if you look at the Needham market stalls, that's an appalling drop of traders across the whole year. And the traders have to park for the whole day. They are a particular group who might only be making £4 profit after paying themselves a minimum wage, and to lose another pound or two in parking, it really is a big hit on the market traders. And we should be doing a deal or something to try and get the market traders. Yeah, they're valuable to our town, and yeah, the market is getting smaller every Saturday. We should be doing something to try and help them survive. Because they work on very small margins, their customers face the parking charge increase, and they themselves face the parking charge increase. And one of the other things is, if this decline in parking numbers is structural, if we're permanently going to see 10 or 20% less people parking in Eton, we should actually be probably having a review of our car parks and having a working group to look at car parking charges, and if, like some of the back of the co-op club car parks, if we should be releasing them for building or whatever, because we have 10,000 people less per month parking. There's valuable land there. I mean, the land at Orchard Street car park, that could be some flats and some housing. So if we are never going to get back to the number of car parking, actually trying to build some affordable housing on that land. Thank you, Chair.
Councillor Watkins.
Thanks, Chair. As you can see from my earphone, I work for Hermes, so I can assure you that online clicking as you like it and parcel delivery is on the increase, not the decrease, so that's probably where some of the car parking goes. But there's other ways of looking at it, Chair. You could look at it that people are cycling in, walking in, coming in on a coach, coming in on a bus, or even coming in on the train. So there's hundreds of ways of looking at the decreasing parking. Market traders, I don't know, I shouldn't know if they do pay, because they already pay for the market, their market store, so I don't actually know if they do pay. They do pay as well, so we double stick around, and that's great. And they have to park in a special car park so that they can get their vans in, which don't talk about, and it's at the back. Used to be a town hall car park here at one stage. So, I wonder if you actually believe Brent when you cut yourself, because you know you're learning all these lessons today. So you must be human. So that's a good thing for you to be looking at. I just don't understand where we're going with this, because if Abbey Street and Vicarage Street do go ahead and we do develop on them, then we'll be losing the car parks anyway. I think it would be sad for a council just to rely on car parking charges. So I'm just confused on why we keep banging on about car parking charges all the time, which is wrong.
Councillor Margrave.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I would like to address an issue that's often been raised by the opposition, in fact, at full council, in relation to car parking. There's often this myth that if we have free car parks across our borough, entirely free at all times, that the high street would be full, that there would be an increased footfall. But actually, if you look at the Mary Porter's report, it's my own personal copy, Councillor, I know you've not got any papers, but this is my copy. But the Porter's report says clearly that free parking does not result in higher town centre usage. And that's actually backed up in the research highlighted in the officer's report. So that's really important in acknowledging that the relationship between footfall within the town centre and parking is a relationship that's incidental. It's not causation. And that is critical when we're having this debate. There are lots of issues on the high street. I often speak about wanting to improve our high street. I've got some real issues around the closure of the co-op that I've raised in the past. I've got real issues about the number of shops we can get in, independent traders. You know, the fact that some opposition members previously were arguing for a out-of-town shopping mall near St. Nicholas Park, I think. These kind of issues are really important, and I've argued that we need to support business business rates. Business rates are far too high, and that's one area that's impacting on the whole economic ecosystem that exists within the high street. But importantly, what parking does, and the Porter's report highlights this, by saying that free parking all day is not the solution. That's something the Porter's report, that was chaired, I understand, by the MP for Nuneaton, Marcus Jones. He chairs that committee. So that report highlights that we shouldn't be going down the free parking route. What we need to do is offer good quality parking and experience in the town centre. And I think we do that really well. One of the problems we've got, though, councillors, is that CCTV, which is really important for people who park in the borough, is not funded by the police commissioner. So if you want to have free parking, are you suggesting, are any of the councillors here who want to have entirely free car parking, because we do have an element of free car parking to encourage the nighttime economy, but are any councillors, I'd be interested in hearing, are you suggesting that we should scrap the CCTV, or would you support me in asking the Conservative police commissioner to put his hand in the pocket and pay for the CCTV in this end of the borough? This end of the county. Thank you, Chair.
Just, Brent, I'm thinking these are more statements rather than questions to your good self.
I would absolutely agree with your assessment there.
Okay. Councillor Wilson.
Thank you, Chair. I would challenge Councillor Margrove to find any Conservative budget proposal which had completely free car parking day in, day out, whenever, wherever. He can't, because he knows what he's just said is a lie. Full stop. End of discussion. There has never been that. The Conservative budgets have looked at and consider, and our viewpoint is that you have to set the right level of car parking, because there is an elasticity of demand. Eventually, you will find that residents and car parkers and shoppers will get resistant to always increasing car parking charges. All they ever seem to see is car parking charges go up. They never ever see them seem to come down permanently. Yes, the services have to wipe their face, but at the end of the day, we are making a profit out of the residents. They aren't just covering the essential costs of the services, they are making a profit. And they are using that £2 million in the budget to subsidise other areas of the budget. And it has happened time and time and time again. Not just in the financial crash that happened in 2008, but before that, when car parking charges were even lower. And it seems to be that the shoppers are an easy target to look at when it comes to finding a source of income to fit in to meet deficits in the budget. And we have found this year that isn't the case. The shoppers have revolted, and they have led to 70,000 less car parking tickets being sold, and also a £200,000 deficit on the anticipated budget in the car parking shopping. That's the figures which have been reported to Cabinet. That's not me making it up, that's what the officers are reporting. The graphs are very interesting indeed. If you look at Appendix 4, for example, where it shows the total number of borough ticket sales, if you look at the high point of 2011 compared to this year of 16-17, that's almost 40,000 tickets less in 1 month. Now, I accept there is a national trend that December didn't quite meet up to expectations, but 40,000 tickets is a hell of a lot, even to... I'm not expecting us to buck the trend, but that is still a significant decrease on where we were at our high point. It seems to be, and the trends, looking at the graphs, and the graphs are easier to follow than the spreadsheets we're presented with, because it collates it all for us. The overall trend seems to be that when we last increased the car parking charges, there was some resistance. Then people started to gain confidence again, and the numbers increased. But now the numbers have gone even lower than at the previous levels when we increased them before. And that is what should be worrying us as a council, because if they are going that low, it does lead to the question of sustainability and viability of the town centre economy. And if we look at the overall car parking metered income at Appendix 6, again, the drop-off is dramatic compared from even 2015-16 in December to this year's figures. Those are very concerning indeed. And I think Cabinet should be looking long and hard at the car parking metering strategy. I would recommend and move as a recommendation that we look at taking up the offer from the manager of Roadwalk, look at the car parking structure, pricing structure in the town centre, because as he himself said at Cabinet and then reiterated in the full chamber, that there are ways of restructuring our pricing strategy which would see us get almost as much income but actually increase footfall in the town centres. That is effectively free consultancy he has offered this council to try and help us. Why aren't we taking that help? Now, Mary Portis was quite right, free car parking isn't the answer, but you have to look at your car parking strategy, your market strategy, your development strategy in the town centres to give an overall package for people to want to come into the town centres. It's the overall package. These are streams. These are threads in the tapestry which we need to look at. And when you start to unpick one, it starts to unravel. And we've been picking away at the car parking stream, and now it's all unravelling. That is the reality of what is happening, Councillor Margrave, and you can't deny it on these figures. I would make that recommendation to Cabinet Chair.
Is that find your seconder?
Yeah.
Councillor Condicor?
Well, Ben, do you want to go ahead?
No, I've got to write people down and just see them, Councillor.
Okay, couple points coming back. One of the things that came out of the comments from the markets traders, and particularly the road walk, is it's converting people from a 1 hour stay to a 2 hour stay. That's actually what you want for business. I do not want free parking. I've never asked for free parking. What the Green Budget did many years ago was ask for free evening parking. What we actually want to do is stop people driving to Hinckley and get us driving to Nuneaton instead. And one of the key factors is if you pay for a pound to park for an hour, after 45 minutes, if you look at your watch, you go back to your car. There's this time anxiety. And everyone in the retail business for Central Avenue says it's a 2 hour rate that's important. Not that you're getting more people driving to town, but actually they're not then going around for 45 minutes and then rushing off. You actually want to get them to stay for the 1 hour 45. And so actually in our parking structure of charges, it's actually the £1.80 we charge for 2 hours, which is actually quite an important charge. And that's the same as what Coventry car parks and the West Orchard charge. So it's looking at that charge. And it'd be great if Brent could do us a graph like the one on Appendix 5 for the 2 hour rate, because I think getting people to stay for 2 hours means they'll have a cup of coffee, they'll do more stuff, they'll look at more market. So I think the 2 hour charge is where we should be investing in, not just to get any increase in the number of people coming, but actually get the 40,000, 35,000 that are coming to actually stay a bit longer. That doesn't cause more environmental damage from driving in and parking the car for longer. It actually causes more trade in the town. And that's the sort of area where I think what Chris was talking about, talking to the road walk. It's using the intelligence of the retailers to keep us our £2 million income, but actually make those journeys into town serve our town better. And also the geographical spread, because it costs exactly the same to park at Paul Bank Street, which is deserted in the daytime, as it does in the road walk. And people have different price points, and we should be thinking about, should we differentiate parking so that we can actually get people on a tighter budget who don't mind walking across the ring road somewhere, yeah, £2 for a pound at somewhere like Paul Bank Street or Orchard Street, because at the moment we're not doing that.
Just to answer, councillors, of course, we don't charge after 6 o'clock for car parking, so the income's sure to be down. In Bedworth, they've actually decommissioned some of the car parks and don't buy at all. So, and the other thing, of course, is Airfield Road, business people can park there all day for a pound.
Okay, any other question? Councillor Brown.
Yes, I think that it's been overplayed, the impact of online shopping. That's always going to be something that's got to be contended with, but we've had easy access to online shopping for well over a decade. It's nothing new. What does seem to stick out, if you look at Appendix 4, is there's definitely one outlier, and that's been the most recent year. There's no doubt that charges have sorry, ticket sales have gone down. And it's, I just don't think it's a coincidence that the ticket prices have gone up. As Councillor Wilson has said, it's very highly publicised. Everyone knows it. And of course, it's going to put people off, and people do feel rushed in and eaten, as Councillor Kandarka said before. And no wonder they're shopping online, because they feel a bit put off by all of this. And if we've got less market stores, if we've got stores, if we've got some shops closing down, then that's all going to make a big difference. So I think in some respects, the Borough Council needs to get a little bit out of the way and at least consider reducing some parking charges and trying to get a few more people to park in Leeton, typically.
I shall take two more speakers and then we'll close it. Councillor Margrave.
Thank you, Chair. Very quickly, really, is that if we compare our parking charges to other areas, we actually fare very well. We offer good value for money. And I just wanted to also pick up on the point that Councillor Wilson made. And I've been called many things, and some of them are true, but being a liar isn't one of them. I think it's really important that we acknowledge, and I'm really glad today that you've acknowledged that, you know, all parking shouldn't be free. The council is not profiting off parking. That money goes into things that benefit the town centre, such as the experience, which is what gets people in. So I think you're wrong in what you said. But importantly, I just want to go back to this issue of funding CCTV and to ask your view about who should fund the CCTV. Should it be this authority that's had a 53% cut, or should it be the police commissioner who has lots of money in their coffers and often benefiting the south of the county? What's your view, Councillor?
I'm not going to get into debate, but we're talking about this particular thing, the car parking fees, and what to do with that.
I think these figures are grossly sort of misrepresented, because I mean, it took me 45 minutes to get through town the other Saturday. I was constantly, there were only three vehicles at a time being allowed through the pedestrian crossing by Asda. You've got a situation where we've got one of our car parks there directly opposite. There's the ability to park for 2 hours for free. And I think that is where the figures are lacking as well. I think people are just parking for 2 hours free and utilising the free car parking that is there. So the footfall into town, I think, is probably a lot higher, but we're not actually seeing the true figures from it, because we have no ability to be able to account for the numbers.
Yeah, well, the thing is, summing it up, one, I can't agree with the recommendation that's put forward, because when you look at this report and the conclusions and the facts are, the perceived wisdom of that, the field, one bomb day for two hours of drive, shoppers over the meeting town centre is perceptive rather wisdom and is not supported by available research. The facts in this report turned around and said that the scaremongering that has been going on between the Conservatives and the Greens is a load of nonsense. And these are the facts. These are not Trump facts. These are facts. What did the comment say? But these are other facts. You know, they're alternative facts. The facts are in front of us, councillors. And it actually turns around and tells us that what's been said is a load of nonsense. That's my point. Right, the recommendation, by the recommendation of Councillor Wilson, which stated
that we recommend to Cabinet that they take up the offer of the Managing Director of Brentwood to investigate the car park pricing structure in the Meeting and Bedworth to benefit the overall council's income stream.
That forms a second. Is there all those in favour?
Can we have our votes recorded?
Yes, by all means. That's three. Those against?
I'll have my vote recorded too, sir.
So the ultimate recommendation is the members of panels to consider the information presented and the various offenders in the report, and the panel will make comments to the cabinet maker of finding the development of Andy Cabinet. So So are we willing to vote the report?
I agree.
Right, item number 8. Are you taking this?
Yes. Thank you very much. In terms of the report that's been presented, what I'd like to do, presented previous panel members, in terms of going through it, have good understanding of the background of the various organisations, is you've got a good overview of the performance for the organisations we're talking about, that is Warwickshire Carver, Warwickshire Employment Rights Service, and the CAB. I'd like to just pick up on a number of developments that are really, really important.
Can I just stop you for a quick second? We normally hope to get representatives here from the various bodies in order to speak to the report. My understanding is that there's a conflict between tonight's meeting and a meeting elsewhere.
Yes. Otherwise, yes, we will have them. Alison was here at the last meeting.
But what I was going to suggest, if the panel wishes to actually agree to it, we've gone through the report currently, if we were to bring this up at the next meeting and ask the representatives to attend so they could actually speak to the report. I'm not trying to delay anything. The only thing I'm trying to do is to get some sort of consensus, and if we get people will be attached to speak to what they're actually doing in their particular organisation, that might be a good thing for us as scrutiny. Councillor Conjurer.
Yeah, I think it would be a good idea to take the body of the report when they're here to ask questions. I think maybe one thing you just tell us about was the McCarver move as well, maybe tonight before we
get
back.
Yeah.
We've done it all, we say about the McCarver move, and then if the panel wishes to do, we'll present this at the next overview scrutiny meeting, and hopefully we can get representatives. So if you can give us some information on the Carver move,
no problem.
And then we'll take it on from there.
Yeah, okay. So with respect to that, as of January, Warwickshire Carver has moved out of 72 High Street, Nuneaton, and into the Newtown Centre. That's kind of been something that's taken, I'd say, maybe about a year from the initial discussions through to fruition. There are a number of benefits for us as a council, but there are probably, I'd say, more benefits for the community voluntary sector and for Carver in terms of how they will be able to do their work. In terms of 72 High Street, it was a residential property, not really fit for purpose, but the CVS had been in there for 30 or so years. And as they had developed, and as the organisation developed, and other organisations that they were housing there, it became quite difficult. It wasn't really complying from the qualities perspective, etc., etc. So when the opportunity was kind of put forward in terms of Newtown Centre being an option, it was something that Carver were very, very interested in, the board collectively were very, very interested in, and together with the assistance of Brent and Les, that has kind of moved forward. And it's been really, really good in that the money that we provide, that the money that we report here in terms of that core funding that comes from ourselves and from the County Council, that enables them to operate. And what has happened is they have then been able to leverage additional money in, and they've already invested and made some significant changes to the Newtown Centre. So they, as of January, are kind of completely based there. All the groups that have been running out of there will remain in situ. There's no issue with that. What we're actually looking at doing is ensuring that more groups are able to operate out of the Newtown Centre, which will help their overall sustainability. But there'll be much more flexibility, because that's something that we weren't really able to provide in terms of the hours and the kind of coverage. And also for them to be able to lever in additional funding. So groups there have been kind of consulted, engaged all the way through. Like, for example, Shape Dance Academy is an organisation that's been there for a long, long time. So groups, as soon as they heard that actually the council's kind of stepping away and someone else is coming in, understandably, were a bit concerned. But Alison and other members of Carver worked with them So that's something that is kind of very, very new, and that started as of January. And together with that, I think just one other point that I'd like to mention, and then we can expand upon later at the next meeting, is before you would see kind of reports from four organisations. So there would be a bit on CARBA, a bit on the Employment Rights Service, a bit on CAB, and a bit from the Volunteer Centre on the volunteer development contract that we commissioned. As of kind of quarter two, so as of August, because of a change of funding, the Volunteer Centre no longer provide the volunteer development services across Nuneaton and Bedworth. That now is being provided by CARBA, who won that tender. That came about for a principal reason that the County Council commissioned for one organisation to provide volunteer development across the county. And what you had was you had a myriad of volunteer centres that were providing that in different ways. And rightly or wrongly, CARBA has won that contract. And Alison, when she's here next, can maybe talk about that. But there are significant benefits of that. The one downside is obviously the volunteer centre has not been able to provide that service. However, we've been working, and I've been working with them for quite a long time. In another way, it's opened up some significant opportunities because it's giving them the ability to focus on other projects that are really, really good. But again, we can maybe expand upon that when the representatives from the organisations are here.
The panel's quite happy with that. We can get more in-depth report next time, and sounds like those are some good positive things.
Yeah. There's a number of other things, but I think we can pick that up
next
when
time.
They're there.
Everybody all right with that then?
We'll agree.
That's up at the next meeting. Okay.
Just one detail. I think it would be worthwhile Carver advertising it a little bit better that they have moved. There's nothing outside that says Carver is there or wasn't at all in the past last time. Okay. And there was never anything to say what was inside Carver anyway. So, and I've always said that we don't know what was on in there, so just getting some better signage outside it. Chase Dance Studios for me. There's nothing to say Carver is there. We ain't going in for a dance.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay.
Right, item number 9, Warwickshire Fire Services. I think the 14.20, I think it's just for information more than anything else.
Thank you, Chair. This document, it'd be nice to have a representative here this evening, really. I don't know whether anybody's been asked, but I would like them to come to a future meeting, Chair. The document is opaque in that it doesn't tell us a great deal, and it really leads to more questions. And the question I've got is, what does this mean for Nuneaton and Bedworth? In particular, does this mean closures? Does this mean a reduction in service? What does it mean? It uses that loved term, efficiency. Now, collaborations are good because I want all Blue Light services to collaborate. So that is a positive element to the report. But what concerns me is what's not being said. However, there is a tone within the report that there has to be a reduction somewhere. A reduction, whether that be in cost or services. And I really want to know what that means for the people of Nuneaton and Bedworth. And I'm sure that our residents, along with me, will be very concerned by this report and the potential for what it could mean for Nuneaton and Bedworth. So I would like to see a future meeting with a representative coming along either to the OSP or to full council to give a presentation on some more detail of their proposition. Now, if they're asking for us to suggest things that we need or would like to see cut, I don't have a list to hand because I don't want anything cut. I think we've had enough cuts over the last 6 years, and there is enough money in the council tax pot overall to make sure that we get good quality emergency services. So I would ask that we have somebody come, Chair.
I'll second that, Chair.
Okay, Councillor Condicott.
Yeah, I was going to say that me and obviously Councillor Bailey, a few others in the council are twin hatters, and the county council is the fire authority, and we'll be discussing the budget in a week's time at Shire Hall.
clearly between all the political parties there is a will to keep the fire service as uncut as possible, and in the early years of the next three-year plan I believe there will be no significant cuts to the fire service. What is in the third year of that plan is penciled in a couple million pounds of saving for the mergers and the alliances that will take years to develop, and whether they develop or not is not always in the hands of Warwickshire, because it might be Hereford and Worcestershire might or might not want to merge. So there is some uncertainty in the sort of third year of the plan. And the other factor that's very important is the attendance of that second fire engine. We have fire stations and fire engines around Warwickshire that are giving us a very good time for the first fire engine arriving. The issue has been with so few retained fire stations actually always manned, with such a spread out county and issues on motorway crashes, is getting that second fire engine. And I think some of the attendance times have been, it's only 15 minutes for the second one. It's been like 76% of the time the second one makes it in the attendance time. So it's a second fire engine that's actually been failing at the moment to always make it. And a lot of politics is in fire, because obviously some of the very rural locations, like Fenny Compton in this world, are really having difficulty getting enough volunteers to maintain their crews. But they're also sacred cows that people in the south wouldn't want to allow rationalisation of some of the southern fire stations. So I think it's a good topic to talk about, but I think we do need to realise this is a county council function. And the final thing I'll say is, down the line, the big risk is the amalgamation of Bedworth and the Neaton Fire Station. And that is something we should be aware of.
Any other thing that has already been proposed and seconded that we're trying to get somebody along for a...
Consultation period ends on March the 10th. This panel won't meet again before then. So,
in terms of what he's going to say, and us as individuals, Chairman, to follow up and take part.
Well, I think that's what the letter was actually.
The letter's trying to drive us towards that.
And just taking something out of turn, we've now also had one, which the Chair will mention shortly.
Chair, if it's possible to move our response to this report at all, because it lacks in detail, but I think we all firmly would stand together in believing that there should be no reduction in the services that people in the Neaton and Bedworth receive. And I would hope that we would send that message clearly back to either the fire service or indeed, depending on what comes forward, the ambulance service. People in the Neaton and Bedworth have, over the last number of years, suffered great reductions in a number of services, and we're at breaking point. So I think it's a cheek to propose taking away our fire stations for each town and for us to have any more cuts. I would actually like to see better provision of S, and I hope that will be fed back, Chair. I'm sure it will be.
Does the panel agree with that?
Yeah.
We can take that forward as a popular recommendation. Also at the same time, chase up individually and our county councillors who's going to deal with this. Councillor Watkins first.
Yeah, Chair. Well, being that we're not going to be able to do a great deal with this, what I would recommend is that we get our comms team to put this link out so that they put it on Facebook, Twitter, whatever, to get individuals to answer towards this, and perhaps get a press release out so that something can go out in the press to make sure that the public know that this is what's out there and that they're invited to go onto this link and have their say. So the more people that know about things, the better, really.
I've done a problem with that. Councillor Conner.
should also mention the arson reduction work, which has been very good. About a year ago, there was a proposal to cut £42,000 from that. The case was made to actually save that, I'm going to say by the Greens, but other parties recognised it was actually a good thing to save. And we had cross-party support to save the funding for the arson reduction team the other year. Now it seems that other parts of Wiltshire want an arson reduction team too, because they can see the valuable work that was being done in actually talking to people, removing potential sources of fire. And so I think it is worth, if we are mentioning services, putting a line in, acknowledging the good work of the arson reduction team and trying to get that continued prevention in there.
With those comments, I'm a compassionate one. Let's go back to the overall response. As I said before, individually, and we'll gee up our county councillors and get them to try and do something also.
No, so we will be getting the comments to put something out and put a press statement.
I was just saying that. There's always a guy's a good idea. Right, we're on to the work programme now.
The
ONS review. Sorry.
Item 10. Page 45.
Yes, on the audit. I just can't see anything where the
glasses. I've got a question. Councillor Watkins.
Chair. We've spent quite some time going through this review. Which is as it is. So we've got the recommendations before you. I'm open to take any questions or anything that you've got for me or any people that was took part in it, and it's as it is.
Any comments from councillors?
I was going to say, it's a very useful review, and I think one of the things that we really were very keen on was things like the forward plan, because actually that gives us this forward visibility so we can actually know what areas are coming up and we don't get spooked by bits. And yeah, I'd like to commend you how useful it was.
Councillor Watkins, can I, there's page 47,
yeah.
5D. Members recommend management team meetings be published on the new council portal or website. I thought this was an internal document rather than a public document.
Cheers.
Rather than being on the website for everybody, I thought this was an internal document. So it should only be on the council's portal.
I think it's off the website.
I think it's on a typo.
Take,
yeah, the council's portal anyway, it's something that's
being worked on.
Right,
yeah.
I think it should say on the website, or the website.
Okay.
And just to update further, Chair, on E, recommendation E, consideration to be given to summary of decisions, I am just querying really whether the members are happy with the YouTube, films going onto YouTube now within about less than 24 hours, generally speaking, whether that is satisfactory or whether you still, whether that summary of decisions was still required.
Chair, if I might, because I think you make a valuable point that we've not actually answered. While on D, on page 47, there's this issue about management team meetings. Are those, you were saying that it should actually read that they should be put on the website?
No. Or it says, or put on the council's portal or the website, and it should have said the new councillor's portal on the website.
Confidential.
But to be clear, those management team meetings, are they for all councillors?
Yes, and popular, but not for public.
Okay, that clears up that. In relation to point E, I think the officer makes a really valid point in that you would end up
going to totally disagree. The video of last night's meeting was 2.25 hours. If you want to know whether the sheltered housing vote was passed, a tweet is far better than looking at 2.25 hours video. So I think they're two different medias. One media is to actually see who said what and be very involved, and the tweeting and the sort of, and particularly like planning applications. If there's three planning applications, you don't want to watch 3 hours of video. You want to know the application on the long shoot was passed or turned down. So tweeting is really important. And it doesn't take a lot of officers' time to...
No, I was meaning more to type up a summary of decisions.
Decisions are actually made, Chair.
Yeah.
They're not changed, are they? It's how we relate them to the...
Chair, it's a working document.
Yeah.
You know, this has consideration to give it. You know, if things would need to be changed, then let's change them. It's a working document. Let's do it. Let's chat and make the changes now so that it can go forward.
Chair, just to be very clear, because I thought what I was speaking to was this issue about putting them immediately online, because normally they take a few, you know, several days, it says here, to be finalised, and I want to make sure we get them right. I think we do already tweet outcomes of some meetings and election results and all those kind of things. So we do already do this. It wasn't that I don't want it to be done. It was more that I wasn't sure this recommendation was needed, if that makes any sense. However, I think that Councillor Kondaka raises an interesting point. You know, the Cabinet meeting did take 2.5 hours. I'm not sure whether 2 hours of that was just Councillor Kondaka. But is it possible for officers to record potentially within the minutes of the meeting or at the time that is on the clock that we move to a new agenda point? And then what you could do is potentially tweet at X minutes in the video, you can go to this particular item. Obviously you don't want to watch the whole video through and do it, but if you could record...
You could skip Councillor Condicor and go to the...
But you could record, you know, move from item 7 to item 8 at 8 o'clock.
Thinking about it, because I put Cabinet on this morning from last night, and there is an element in there where it tells you you can put comments. So in the comments we could put the time for each agenda decision. So each item, so we could put in the comment, we could say agenda item 10, minute 53.6. And then somebody could fast forward to 53.6 and just see the decision.
Just slide the bar.
Yeah,
the
so by just sliding the bar.
I'm with 56 minutes.
So that would.
I've just watched myself twice on the planning meeting where I was staying.
So.
And told the wife where it was.
We have difficulty with getting the written minutes is when we write them, what the clerk writes and what maybe sometimes legally we have to put isn't always the same. So we have to check before we make that a final minute. But obviously, if we can point you to where the decision's made, then you hear what's said. And you do with that what you will. It's not the same as a written minute.
Councillor Watkins, you
are. Right, so what are you saying? You want that changed too? I don't know. Do you want it changed, or do you want it taken out, or what?
I think Shirley will take the points and consider putting them in there.
I mean, it says there, consideration to be given to summary decisions for the council and cabinet meetings being tweeted.
Yeah.
So we're giving the officers, if we've got an officer there, freedom to tweet things.
Yeah, I think the tweeting element of it is slightly different because it depends whether a comms officer is there.
Yeah.
My clerk isn't able to be taking minutes, concentrating on the meeting and then tweeting.
No.
I think that's unreasonable. So if a comms officer's available and comes to the meeting like they were last night, presumably she tweeted last night while the meeting was going on, I don't know. But I certainly think that I can certainly arrange that when we put the recording of the meeting onto YouTube, that we identify where those decisions are. I can do that.
That's sorted.
The rest of it maybe needs to stay there for consideration by the central services portfolio or whoever will get the job ultimately.
Right, can you adjust that word into read
yeah.
that?
Yeah.
Does that assist you?
Anybody else?
For finally, Jack, we just thank Councillor.
No, I just hold you there. Yeah. I'd like to thank the councillor and the working party for all the hard work they've put in, and hopefully we'll get a more up-to-date coverage of what happens within the borough. Okay, thanks. Everybody all right with that? Yeah.
Agreed. Yeah. It did slim it out a bit, Chair. It did take a few documents out, so
yes.
It was worth doing.
Yes, I think so. At the end of the day, I think we've got a reasonable fit for what we intend to do. It's always going to be about tweaking rather than tweaking budgets. So along these lines. Right, we're going to the work programme now. Everybody's finally there.
We're at the work programme.
Right, we've already agreed that the volunteer community sector come back to it. We've got one item, new item, is that we've had a request from a member of the public and from our MP in the meeting about the Griff Arm, restoration of the Griff Canal Arm. Does the panel feel as though that should go on as an item in the future? Councillor Wilson.
Thank you, Chair. I seem to recall at the last full council, we resolved to move it to the relevant OSP anyway after Mr. Baxter spoke. Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm not 100% sure she's the relevant OSP. I had a feeling it might be environment and planning because of it was on about potentially fitting in with the borough plan and other aspects of infrastructure and development. But I think the full council already resolved for it to be put onto a work programme.
Well, my indication was is that it was requested to come to this panel. So I'm asking this panel whether
I'm happy for it to go on. I'm just asking for clarification between what full council said and whether this negates it.
No, it's the particular panel that it should be going on, and my information is that it's been requested to come to this panel, and this panel must decide whether it should go to our future work programme. Councillor Condicott.
Yeah, I was going to support that we have a look at it. I was a bit querying the same thing about which panel it goes to, but also which officer would actually then present it. Would it be an economic development officer or would it be a planning policy officer? Yeah, because obviously if we're discussing something in the future, we need someone to sort of facilitate that in terms of telling us what it involves, what it costs, and whether to go or not.
I'm sure we'll get a proper officer here that
right
on. Councillor Dunn.
Yes, as Councillor also said, I seem to recall that it was recommended to go to planning and environment because I remember thinking, well, that's what I'm on, so I'd be interested when that comes forward. The video is online, so we can have a look at that to, just have a look at what was said at the meeting, but that's what I remember being said, and
I think the minute did say the appropriate or the relevant OSP, and I did ask all the chairs. I think the reason that it was felt that it should come to this panel as opposed to the others was because it was relating to trust status and the forming of a trust and so on, which it was felt would sit here rather than, and obviously the funding and financial side of that, rather than it going to planning and environment, which basically would be dealing with the environmental issues around. That's not to say it doesn't go to both, ultimately, but that was why.
Councillor Watkins.
Chair, if I remember right, it was when it was put forward, at no cost to the council. So I'm a bit unsure.
to go through the full council to go to the appropriate committee. This was deemed as the appropriate committee for it to come to, and then when the report comes, we can deal with those other things. Councillor Magrave.
Thank you, Chair. Can I begin by saying I am actually in. I know it's a procedural issue, really, that might make me sound rather pedantic. But I do have some concern about a member of the public, especially a member of the public who I understand doesn't live in the borough, having their own report attached to a council agenda. Now, I would love it if, you know, all of my residents could put forward their thoughts attached to a council agenda, as I could write my own reports. But I think it's important that in future we have reports that are independently written and objective from officers of this council. You know, I think, you know, that is a serious issue. I'm not happy about Mr. Baxter's report being attached to this agenda. However, that said, this is an interesting issue and one that I think merits consideration by the authority, and I did support that proposal at council. And I think this committee is actually well placed to look at that in the whole, rather than from a planning perspective or a leisure perspective or a housing perspective. We've got the ability to look at this in the round. So I think we're well placed to do that, and I welcome that, Chair.
And I shall go back to the point again that was suggested at the full council that we were to look at this, and it was suggested once again that this would be the right panel for it to have a look at. So that's why the report is attached to this, because it was felt that we were the right people to have a look, look at it.
Now that recommendation, it goes on the forward plan. When we will not on
work
what time?
The work program.
Check, and I just, for clarity, the point I'm making is
I understand your report, I understand,
This is not a report of this council.
I understand that.
We take requests for the work programme from the public, and generally speaking they would fill out a work programme suggestion form. And I take your point on board, this is what was submitted to the council and sent to me by the managing director. Obviously it would have took me time to then put this onto our form, and I may have got it wrong or not done it right, so I thought it was easier to do it this way. But in hindsight, maybe what I should have done was say, thank you, Mr. Baxter, for your report, and here is a form for you to fill in for us to take to the committee. But
it is what it is. But once again, it goes back to the council decision, and I'm trying to fit it into our work programme in order to get it done.
I think if Shirley had done that, given him the form, it would not have been a friendly act. I mean, fill one out yourself, it takes some pretty deep thought at each section of the form to actually get to something which you want to say and draw out the point you're trying to make. But I think this document makes so many references to the borough plan. I just wonder if we shouldn't have a filter of this document through officers who are administering the borough plan to see where it fits in. I mean, he's clearly quoting strategies and so on. If they could quantify also some of the rough financial impacts of what's being asked for and whether it's feasible, because it does mention the Canal Trust and other people who presumably have funds. They would have a volunteer force of some description if they did decide to adopt it as a project. And then at the same time, there are, I understand, commercial interests around this issue that could be developed and make a contribution to the initial rough work and clearance that clearly the canal needs. So if it could be drawn together as a document that just explores the potential of it, and the implications for the council itself, I think that would be useful.
And we've only got one more meeting, Chair, so it's unlikely to come this side of this year, but obviously it can go forward to for consideration on the next work programme.
Everybody happy with that?
Yeah.
Agreed.
Next item we've got here, the Freedom of Information Complaints Working Party is to be set up. We have only three members of the Working Party. is there's Chris, Jill and John. There's a suggestion that we might need one or more participants. Would anybody like to volunteer? Or should we put it out again to see if anybody else would be willing to go in this working group? Councillor Condivar.
I think one of the issues in the next 6 weeks is the above plan consultation and various budget things. So I think that might be why you're not getting volunteers, because there's actually, and then you've got elections. So it is a crowded time of commitments at the moment.
Depending on, Chair, depending on how serious the group wants it, I'd take it off the March meeting. And not carry forward with the working group at the present moment in time. Move it till later, 2017.
What does the panel think of that? Everybody happy with that?
I think the one on March on the work programme there is for Chris to update on the figures.
Yeah.
Not the update from the working group. Just at the last meeting, we asked for members of the working group.
Yeah,
I sent out the email.
Yes, I'm just trying to get something out.
Yeah.
Chris, do you want to say something?
Well, no, if Chris is just going to update on that. It's just that I don't want to see this freedom of information complaints thing dragging on, because it does need some work.
Yeah.
It's difficult to make them quite, or even make a compliment in the system that we've got at the minute. And a lot of complaints, compliments go astray.
Councillor Mandev.
Thank you, Chair. I see how important it is for members of the public to be able to make a complaint and get issues they've got resolved. I also think if people want to request information, they should have that right. And it's one of the things that a Labour government did that I'm really proud of, one of many things that is. So I'm happy to put myself forward if it means that the committee is able to continue to undertake its work. As long as the committee meets, that I've got advance notice and can make sure that I'm available work-wise. But I'm happy to continue if that will help the work carry on. If not, I'm happy to go on next municipal year, Chair.
So what's the panel respond to about volunteers about the conscript?
Yeah. That'll be four, Chairs. Just, we have to have three to be quorum. And if we get down to just starting with three, we quite often end up not being quorum. So I'd like at least four.
I don't plan to die in between.
Five, preferably. Yeah, but things happen.
So we're happy to counsel that, baby. So we'll proceed with this working group. The council pack will be in there.
Oh, we'll make some. I'll send out some dates, Chair.
Yeah. Everybody all right with that?
Yeah.
And the last thing I've got here is we've got working next meeting.
The next meeting. So we've got the licensing policy. If you remember, we had the child sex exploitation, and there were some issues raised around licensing and whether they were being trained to spot various things. And Linda Downs wanted to update and sort of give a progress report, if you like, to the panel. So they're coming back in March, and there'll be the licensing bit included within that. We've got the integrated performance report, there's Chris's Freedom of Information and Complaints report. You've asked for the voluntary and community bodies to come back in March. I think when I read through the Gresham Road report, it suggested that it should come back. And I've written down there March-June time. Given what was said at the meeting, you might want to leave that to June rather than...
I think the suggestion was that basically that was going to be 12 months, so it'll be the same next year,
so
rather than
you want
than
to do that, yeah. Change that to 18.
I agree, yeah.
Okay, that's no problem, we can do that. And I would have thought that was enough for you,
yeah.
But to look at some, take some else off your list, that's fine. Can I just ask, the town centre paving maintenance, now I know that was brought up some time ago, and shortly after the meeting, I noticed they were all over the town centre doing bits of paving and so on and so forth.
That's because we've got sick coming moaning, but...
Right, is it still an issue that needs to be on here?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, that's fine.
Because we were writing a letter, I think, to county, or portfolio holder, to ask about the investment in the borough compared to Stratford, Warwick, etc.
Yeah.
So we still need to follow that up and see what the comparison is.
So we'll do all that. Anything else to show me in the workflow?
Not at the moment, Chair, that looks fine.
The last item I've got here is any other item. Planned engagement event by the West Midlands Ambulance Services at Shire Hall on the 30th of January, 11 to 12:30, on their annual quality accounts, but provides opportunity also for councillors to raise the need and bedwell priorities in regard to this service. So if anybody wishes to